Good evening, everyone. It feels like an enormous, enormous privilege and an enormous blessing to look out on all of your faces. It's really unbelievably moving and very, very special to see all of you together. So many different parts of our extended Heschel community all coming together to commemorate together. Thank you all for being here. It's really, as I say, just an enormous blessing. I want to just thank everyone who made this program possible tonight. Like everything else, this was not the program we originally had planned. And once again, an inspiring team of people made it possible for us to come together despite these very challenging circumstances and really commemorate as a community. So first, I want to thank Jeannie Fisher and Sharon Schneier, the incredible leaders of the Holocaust Commemoration Committee and the entire Holocaust Commemoration Committee. If we were in person in our Rowanna Sharofsky Theater, I would ask all of the members of the committee to rise. I can't do that tonight. It's one of the limitations, but please know how grateful we are for your incredible vision and passion and leadership, each and every one of you. I want to thank the amazing team of Susan Cardos, Cleo Auckland, Hani Radinsky, and Gabe Godin, more on Gabe Godin in a moment, for organizing and conceiving of and putting together every detail of this program. And to Aliza and Sivan Nemiroff, who you'll hear play music shortly, and to our inspirational founder, Peter Geffen, who will lead us in Elmir Hamim and Kaddish at the end of the program. Special, special thanks are due to Dan Senor and Helen Senor, who I see sitting with Eli and Asher and Campbell right in front of me. It has been one of the great privileges of my time as both a parent and a head of school at Heschel to get to know Helen, Dan's mother, Eli and Asher's grandmother, who, to my knowledge, never missed a happy occasion that involved one of her grandsons at Heschel, despite living in Israel. I can attest to that because that's how I came to know her. And she is an inspiring, incredible woman whose presence lifted up so many of our happy Heschel events. She graciously agreed to tell her story tonight. And when we couldn't have her in person, Dan and she graciously agreed to tell the story together with the incredible partnership of Gabe Godin. So Dan, Asher, Eli, Campbell, Helen, thank you all for sharing your family's incredible story with us. It is a privilege to have you all across three generations as my friends, and a privilege that you were willing to share so much of what's made your family so special over the years with all of us tonight. So thank you all for being here, and I will turn you over to Jeannie Fisher to introduce the rest of the program.
Good evening, everyone. Can you hear me? Yeah. And thank you so much on behalf of me and my co-chair, Sharon Schneier, and the entire wonderful committee. I want to thank you for joining us this evening for our annual Yom HaShoah commemoration. It really is uplifting that even though we can't be physically together, we're coming together in this way this evening, this year, for this annual remembrance. And thank you, Ariella, for so eloquently covering all of the thank yous. I don't want to take up too much time, but I really would be remiss if, on behalf of the committee, I didn't extend my thanks as well to the institutional advancement team, to our director of technology, to Aliza and Sivan and Peter, because you were so inventive this year and so supportive, and without you tonight would not have been possible and would not have been as meaningful as it is. So thank you all. I just want to say that, you know, every year at the Passover Seder, we say that in each generation, a person is obligated to see him or herself as if they were taken out of Egypt. And being that I'm the granddaughter of four survivors and grew up in a community of survivors, this has always been very meaningful to me. But again, as with everything this year, it revealed its multiple layers to me. The fact that we must have empathy for those who are suffering because we were slaves in Egypt, and that we must acknowledge our vulnerability and our interconnectedness, for we were the afflicted people crying out for deliverance. And also that no matter how dark our circumstances, we must always maintain hope for a better future because we experienced the Exodus. And on that note, I'd like to end my introduction by sharing a very short excerpt from a poem written by Elie Wiesel that I read at my Seder this year, entitled Ani Ma'amin, I Believe. And I feel that it just so poignantly expresses at once the abject despair of the Shoah that we are obligated to remember, and still the survival of the human spirit and the Jewish people's unwavering faith in redemption. A camp, an inmate, a creature without a name, a man without a face, without a destiny. It is night, the first night of Passover. The camp is asleep. He alone is awake. He talks to himself soundlessly. I hear his words. I capture his silence. To himself, to me, he is saying, I have not partaken of matzot, nor of maror. I have not emptied the four cups, symbols of the four deliverances. I did not invite the hungry to share my repast or even my hunger. No longer have I a son to ask me the four questions. No longer have I the strength to answer. The parable of Chag Gadiah is misleading. God will not come to slay the slaughterer. The innocent victims will go unavenged. The ancient wish, L'shana haba'ah b'Yerushalayim, will not be granted. I shall not be in Jerusalem next year or anywhere else. Next year I shall not be. And then how do I know that Jerusalem is there, far away, that Jerusalem is not here? Still, I recite the Haggadah as though I believe in it, and I await the prophet Elijah as I did long ago. I open my heart to him and say, welcome, prophet of the promise. Welcome, herald of redemption. Come share in my story. Come rejoice with the dead that we are. Empty the cup that bears your name. Come to us. Come to us on this Passover night. We are in Egypt, and we are the ones to suffer God's plagues. Come, friend of the poor, defender of the oppressed, come. I shall wait for you, and even if you disappoint me, I shall go on waiting. Ani ma'amin. Now it is my pleasure to turn the program over to Eliza and Sivan, who will play Eli Eli for us, the 1945 song by Israeli composer David Zahavi, adapted from the wistful 1942 poem by Hungarian Jewish resistance fighter Hanna Senesh. It is loosely translated, O Lord, my God, I pray that these things never end. The sand and the sea, the rush of the waters, the crash of the heavens, the prayer of man.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. That was beautiful. And if you could all now turn your attention to the video presentation that was created especially for this event from an interview that Dan Senior conducted with his mother, Helen.
It is a real honor to have Helen Senior here, my mother and the grandmother of Campbell's, and my kids, our Heschel kids, Eli and Asher, in fifth and sixth grade, to join us, not only for the Yom HaShoah program, but to join us from Jerusalem. She was supposed to be in the United States to be at participating in Heschel's Yom HaShoah events in person, but obviously, given the circumstances, she can't be, so she's in her apartment in Jerusalem, beamed in by a Zoom. This is a conversation my mother and I have had in the past, and we're excited to share it with the community, as difficult as the topic is. So, Mom, let's just start with, what town are you from in Europe? And if you could tell us a little bit about what your family was like.
I was born in a city called Košice, which is in eastern Slovakia, into a Orthodox family, and led a very typical circumscribed life up until the time that the Nazis came to Košice. I don't think that the community was aware what was going on in the rest of Europe. The Germans arrived in Košice in the summer of 1944.
And just about your family a little bit. So it was an Orthodox Jewish community in Košice. How many siblings?
I am the youngest of five. Two brothers and sisters older than I. They must have had a sense of what was coming. And three of them dispersed to different parts of Slovakia.
So what was your father's occupation?
He was a wine distributor.
Your family knew something was going on in Europe in 44, but the family didn't know the full extent of what was going on.
They were dealing with anti-Semitism all their lives, one way or another, but not to the extent of what happened.
Tell us about that day where the Nazis came to your town, to Košice, and your community.
From what I remember, my father and I went on an errand. And when we returned, the apartment was empty. And we found out that the Nazis had swept through the Jewish community and took them all, or as many as they could, took them to the grounds of a brick factory.
What did they tell the Jews?
I think they were just told to go. Okay. Now, my father was very upset. He didn't know what to do. He finally decided to take me to the grounds of the brick factory and walk in to where the rest of the Jews were.
And where was your mother at that point?
She and my sister had been taken to the brick factory while we were out on this errand.
So you're the youngest of five, you're with your father, your mother's right. With your sister, and you're saying your other three siblings at that point, they knew something was up, so they scattered.
Right.
What did your parents do next?
My mother, a very gutsy woman, had an inkling that no good was going to come out of this. And there were farmers coming in and out to the brick factory, and she must have had some money on her. She negotiated with one of them to smuggle us out. My mother, my sister, and I got on this wagon. He covered us up with potato sacks. I remember it very clearly. And smuggled us out. The next day, with the same farmer, she sent back to get my father. And his answer was that she was foolish to do what she did, and he was not going to come, and there was no reason, there's no way that God would allow anything to happen to the Jews.
So he refused to go.
He refused to go, and he stayed at the brick factory. And then I remember walking through forests and hills, and eventually we ended up in a town called Hlohovice. There was a Jewish community center building there, so of sorts. And so we walked in there, and we were told that a number of Jews had arranged with the superintendent of the building to hide from the Nazis in the attic of the building. My mother did not want to go up there and stayed street level. She and I went for a walk, and as we were walking, there was a German soldier trying to come toward us, and she quickly realized the danger, and she started running and pulling me like a rag doll with her. We went back to the Jewish Community Center and promptly asked to join the people in the attic, where we stayed for 6 months.
Roughly, how many people would you say were in that attic?
About 20, I would think. And also, it had the superintendent had arranged for the door to the attic to be disguised so that anyone passing by would not be able to know that what was going on inside.
And this superintendent was Jewish or not Jewish?
Not Jewish. And he provided us with food and whatever. He was paid by the people there to.
But he was also doing it out of, I mean, he was a righteous Gentile. He was risking his life.
He was endangering his life.
You're in this attic with a bunch of people for 6 months. Is anyone at this point, your mother or any of the adults there saying, what's the plan? How does this end?
There was just a lot of fear of not being found. That's what it really was. And there was one incident that I will never forget. The superintendent had a girlfriend, and he confided in her that there were Jews hiding in the attic. Now, I should go back a little bit. When the German soldiers arrived in Hlohovice, they found the Jewish Community Center a very convenient place to stay. So there were the German soldiers on the main level, and all these Jews hiding in the attic.
And the soldiers had no idea?
No, they had no idea. And the superintendent confided in his girlfriend that he was hiding Jews in the attic. Well, they had a fight, and the girlfriend, in revenge, went in the courtyard and started yelling, there are Jews hiding in the attic in this building. Well, of course, the soldiers started to look, and we all got dressed. We were sure that this was the end. And they never found us. We heard them looking, but they never found us, which was quite amazing. We stayed there for about 6 months. And after that, my oldest brother came for us. He knew where we were. And he convinced us to leave Hlohovice. And we followed him and walked to another town called Svatý Mikuláš. We walked into this town saying that we were war refugees, never mentioning that we were Jewish. A woman on the street said, you know, I have a hut behind my building. You are welcome to stay there. And we stayed there for at least 6 months.
And she was not Jewish?
She was not Jewish.
And did she know that you were Jewish?
No, she didn't. And in fact, at one point, she took me aside and said to me, are you sure you're not Jewish? And I had sense enough to say, oh, of course not. She wouldn't have done it if she had known that we were Jewish.
Tell me a little bit about how kept up Jewish ritual, Jewish tradition in any way. 6 months is a long time. It was one thing when you're living with all those Jews in the attic, here you and your mother by yourselves with someone who doesn't think you're Jewish.
Well, it was a trick because came from an Orthodox, very Orthodox home. When Hanukkah came, my mother covered the one window in the place, and my brother was with us, and my sister and I. And he managed to make a menorah, and he said the Hanukkah blessings. And if anyone had found us out, that would have been the end. But I will never forget. We celebrated Hanukkah.
Did your mother ever think we're risking our lives by trying to maintain Jewish observance?
Jewish observance was so ingrained in our lives that there was no question that we would do it if we could. And I don't know that she, I mean, everything we did was risking our lives. We did it.
And you stayed there for 6 months, and then what?
The Russians arrived, which was very welcome, but also a mixed blessing. They wanted to scare the living daylights out of us just by shooting at the ceiling. But they freed us from the Germans. And I remember once that on the way to leaving Lohovice, we were marching, we were walking toward Košice. And we could hear the whistling of bullets over our heads. I guess they were still fighting with each other. I should point out that our experience was always filled with fear of being caught. But it was at no point on the level of being in a concentration camp.
I want to come to that and come to your return to Košice. But before we do that, can you tell us at a high level one of your sister Gita, your older sister Maya and Gita's story?
She went to another town and she connected with a family where she was helping out with their children. And the parents, the father was very ill, so she had to leave them with the two children.
How old was Gita at this point?
She was 18.
So she was 18 and some random family
handed her two children to save, and she just wandered off wherever to try and get away. And she had some near misses, but she was very good looking and she was able to charm the German soldiers to leave her alone. And to this day, those children who are now grown adults call her their second mother.
But coming back to your story, the Russians come, you go back to Košice with your mother.
And my sister and brother.
And the community, the Jewish community, what's left of it, reunites. Just to bring the story back to the beginning, that fateful day in the factory, your mother made the decision to leave with you, to sneak out. Your father made the decision to stay because he believed nothing would happen to him. And then you learned after the war that from other survivors from the community who survived Auschwitz, that the people in that brick factory were taken on a train to Auschwitz.
Right.
And your father was on that train.
And he was one of the first victims to go to the gas chamber.
And at that point, your family is in Košice, they're reunited, and you make the family makes the decision after all of that to stay in Košice.
But only till 1949, because that's when the communists came in. And we certainly didn't want to stay under communism. We left Košice via Austria and via Paris. We stayed a year in Paris in order to get our papers to come to Canada. I should point out something interesting. In Paris, my mother enrolled me in a public school, mm-hmm. which was 6 days a week, including Saturday. And I refused to write on Saturday. The principal said, well, I'm sorry, if you won't write, you can't stay here, which was interesting that even after the war, there was this prejudice.
So in 2007, you and Campbell and I, while Campbell was pregnant with Eli, we went to Košice, back to your hometown, and it was the first time you were there since the war, right?
Right.
And we visited Auschwitz.
That was quite a very painful experience to be there. Although what I marveled at, and marveled is probably not the right word, was shocked to see how many Polish people were having picnics on the grounds of Auschwitz, right? And it felt, that was painful.
I want to go to your life now. So you have four children, you have a lot of grandchildren, you made the decision in the summer of 2014 to make Aliyah. Tell us what that feels like to you, having been through what you have been, having lived this entire very traumatic period of Jewish history. not read about it, not studied it, but lived it. And then to go from that to being a citizen of Israel.
It's something that I will never take for granted. And just generally to live here, to see the freedom of people to observe and do and be whatever they want to be.
You know, I have this amazing photo of you and Wendy and Wendy's kids, three generations of Jewish women, some of whom were serving in the army at that point. Wendy, who's a professional, my sister, raising a family in Israel, you, the grandmother, and a recent immigrant to Israel, these three generations going to vote. You've talked a lot about the idea of voting.
To be living in a country, a sovereign Jewish country, where there was total freedom of observing, there was a democracy.
But you couldn't have imagined in a million years earlier in your life.
Never. I mean, to think back when I was voting, that there was a time when I was hiding in an attic, it's hard to think of that in the same breath. It was a dream come true.
So Mom, why do this? Why tell the story?
Since we're just past Passover, where it says in the Haggadah, "Vehigadata lebincha," you shall tell your sons and your daughters. It felt very appropriate that I tell this story to the Heschel Jewish community, especially since Dan and Campbell's sons and my grandsons, Eli and Asher Senor, will hear it and will get to appreciate what I'm about, where I come from, and what I have experienced in my life.
Wow. Dan, I'm looking for you on my Zoom. What a gift. What an incredible, incredible gift you just gave to our whole community. Thank you to Dan. Thank you to Helen. I want to say on a very personal level, my family had the incredible privilege just this past Hanukkah of lighting Hanukkah candles with Helen at Wendy's home in Jerusalem. Not in a hut where they had to be hidden. And Helen is filled with life and light. Thank you, Dan. Thank you, Helen, for sharing your story. Thank you, Campbell and Eli and Asher, for generously sharing your family's history with all of us. Thank you, Gabe, for making it possible for us to all experience this tonight. What an incredible, incredible privilege, an incredible blessing. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Senior Brown family. And thank you, Helen. In a moment, I'm going to ask Peter Geffen, our founder, to say the El Malei Rachamim and Kaddish for us. I think Peter's going to ask us to rise. If you would just adjust your cameras accordingly so we all still have the beautiful privilege of seeing each other face to face. Thank you, Peter.
So before we chant the El Malei Rachamim, for which if you're able, you can stand and otherwise it's fine, I'm going to light a yahrzeit candle, a memorial candle. If you have a candle, you can light it at this point. El Malei Rachamim Shochen Bahamromim Hamitzei Menucha Hanechona Tachat Kanfei Hashechina B'mahalot Kedoshim Utehorim Kezohar harakia mazehirim et nishmot kol acheinu b'nei Yisrael Anashim, Nashim Vitav, Shenit Bechu, Vishenechniku, Vishenesrifu, Vishenehergu, Veganeheden, Tehemenu Chatam, Anaha Bala Rachamim. Hastireim b'seiter k'nafecha li'olamim U'tzeror b'tzeror ha'chayim et nishmotehem Adonai u'nachalatam V'yanuchu v'shalom al mishkevotehem V'nomar Amen. Now we recite Kaddish. In your homes, you can recite together. Yitgadal v'yitkadash shemei rabba v'alma divrach yirutei v'yamlich machutei v'chayechon uv'yomechon uv'chayei d'chol beit Yisrael ba'agala uv'zman kariv v'imru amen. Yehei shemei rabba mevorach li'olam uli'olmei almaya. Yitbarach v'yishtabach V'yit pa'ar, v'yit romam, v'yit naseh, v'yit hadar, v'yit aleh, v'yit halal, shmei dekudusha b'richu. Le'elam min kol birchata v'shirata, tushbechata v'nechemata, da'amiran b'yalma v'yimru amen. Yehei shlomo rabba min shemaya, v'chayim aleinu v'yal kol Yisrael v'yimru amen. Oseh shalom b'mromav, hu ya'aseh shalom, Aleinu v'al kol Yisrael v'al kol Yoshvei Tevel v'imru Amen. You may remain standing for Hatikva.
Thank you all for being here tonight. Thank you for coming together, as always, as a community. Thank you. Thank you to everybody who made this evening possible. Have a good night and see you tomorrow at school.